Good evening, everyone. Yashoda Group of Hospitals welcomes you all for the activity of this week. And this week, we'll be discussing a very commonly and frequently discussed topic. It's about pulmonary thromboembolism. This is a topic which is very regularly discussed by our pulmonology colleagues, our cardiology colleagues. Today, we are here, emergency physicians, discussing about this condition. So, what is special about the presentation of this condition in the emergency room, and why should we really discuss about this condition? The pulmonary thromboembolism, it poses as a great master in the emergency room. Basically, it presents in different kinds of forms. That is, it ranges from a sick, very sick patient to very stable patient. And a few of the times the patient walks into the emergency room or into the OPDs, they're quite stable. So the presentation can be very different. So let us see why this happens. So is the diagnosis of this condition so difficult? Yes, it is, especially when the attack. Pardon? Especially when the episodes are unprovoked episodes. What are these provoked and unprovoked episodes? Most of the guidelines classify this condition into these two conditions. The provoked episodes being precipitated because of conditions, pre-existing conditions like any limb swelling, any condition that leads to the immobilization of the patient, like any prior episodes of DVT, any prior episodes of surgeries, trauma that lead to immobilization of the patient. And in unprovoked conditions, there is no history of all these mentioned causes. And one thing to remember is that most venous thromboembolisms diagnosed in ED are unprovoked. And the rate of recurrence in unprovoked attacks is threefold that in cases of provoked episodes. Coming to the clinical features, the hallmark of pulmonary embolism, the hallmark symptom is dyspnea, which is unexplained by the auscultatory findings. And coupled with the ECG changes, and whenever there is no clear alternative diagnosis on chest X-ray, then this is the hallmark in the diagnosis of pulmonary embolism. And the second most common symptom in pulmonary embolism is the chest pain, which is pleuritic in nature. And the classic location of the chest pain in pulmonary embolism is in the thorax, between the clavicles and the costal margin. And this increases with cough or breathing. This pain is not substernal and not emanating from the skin or the muscle. Coming to the physical examination, the abnormal vital signs that in this condition, they suggest acute cardiopulmonary stress that manifests as tachycardia, tachypnea, and a low pulse oximetry value. And the patients even sometimes have mild fever. Unfortunately, pulmonary embolism does not present with all these classic findings on floor practically. And pulmonary embolism does not predictably alter any vital sign. Approximately half of the patients do not have any tachycardia. The heart rate is less than 100 in these patients. And nearly one third of the patients have abnormal early vital signs while presenting in the ED. And in no time, they normalize in the emergency room. And there are various other gray areas in this condition. The amount of clot burden, that is the size of the clot does not have any correlation with the initial heart rate or the pulse oximetry value. Fever neither increases nor decreases the probability of pulmonary embolism diagnosis. Unilateral limb swelling increases the probability of pulmonary embolism by 3 times. And one important thing to remember is the presence of wheeze reduces the probability of pulmonary embolism by 50%. The overall gestalt or clinical gestalt interpretation of labeling the patient as sick or not sick doesn't work out in diagnosis of this condition, because this labeling the patient as sick or not sick cannot diagnose this condition. It can be quite deceiving. And there is an interesting study saying that patients diagnosed with pulmonary embolism in the ED were more likely to smile during their physical examination. So with so many gray areas and points in our mind, let us see how to diagnose this condition, which is a diagnostic challenge always to the emergency room physician. These things, let us see with the help of two cases where typical and atypical presentations were noticed. And let us see and try to understand how to overcome the hurdles in diagnosis of this condition. Now I give it over to Dr. Ria, who will take us through the clinical cases.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone. I'll be taking you through two clinical scenarios which presented ultimately as pulmonary thromboembolism. The first is a typical presentation of the condition, followed by a second, which would be an atypical presentation of the condition. We had a 38-year-old female who was a known case of hypertension and hypothyroidism, who presented to the ER a couple of months ago with complaints of progressively worsening shortness of breath lasting a couple of days, exacerbated the previous night. She also gave us a history of bilateral limb pain for the last week. She had no relevant cardiovascular or pulmonary history. The only presenting complaints were shortness of breath with bilateral limb swelling. Proceeding to the primary survey, we found that the airway was patent with tachypnea on assessment of breathing and ventilation. Her respiratory rate was more than 30 per minute, with SATs of almost 86% in room air. The critical action taken on this finding was that oxygen supplementation was initiated by a Hudson mask at 5 liters per minute, on which we found that the saturation improved to 95%. We found that the circulation, disability, and exposure on primary survey were satisfactory. These following primary adjuncts were initiated. The electrocardiogram showed the following findings. There was sinus tachycardia. The heart rate was approximately 120 beats per minute with right axis deviation and T wave inversions in the right sided precordial leads, which would be found on V4 to V6. Also, lead 3 showed significant T wave inversions. Sinus tachycardia, right axis deviation, and right ventricular strain pattern were found on the ECG taken on admission of the patient to the ED. Following which, we did a screening 2D echocardiogram, which showed a fair to good LV function with dilated right atria and right ventricles and a dilated inferior vena cava measuring approximately 2.1 centimeter. Following which we did an ABG analysis, which showed that the metabolic parameters of the patient were normal. The ample history showed that the patient was hypertensive and hypothyroid on regular medication, with a history of having been detected to have varicose veins, and she was put on conservative management for the last 1 month. Events leading to the current illness were that a history of progressively worsening shortness of breath was being told for the last 2 days, exacerbated since the previous night, associated with bilateral lower limb swelling and pain. Proceeding to the secondary survey, we found that the head to foot examination yielded the following findings. She was an obese female with the following examinations found on the testing of both lower limbs. The left lower limb showed a swelling, which when compared to the right was 4.5 centimeters greater. It was a tender limb with pitting edema. Peripheral pulses were well felt bilaterally, and we could also notice varicose veins or dilated veins on bilateral lower limbs. The head to foot examination was otherwise unremarkable. Proceeding to the systemic examination, the respiratory system was generally normal. We did a detailed respiratory system examination, except for the tachypnea noted initially, which subsided on 5 liters of oxygen supplementation, and hypoxia, which was noted, again corrected on oxygen supplementation. There was no relevant finding found on respiratory system examination. The rest of the systemic examination was also normal. From all of the above findings, along with the clinical examination and the history, we proceeded to find a provisional diagnosis of pulmonary thromboembolism. Following which, the following measures were taken in the ED. Vascular access was secured with 2 large bore IV cannulae. Oxygen was supplemented via Hudson mask at 5 liters per minute. The following secondary adjuncts were initiated following a provisional diagnosis of pulmonary thromboembolism. We sent the following blood tests. We sent a troponin I and an NT-proBNP along with a D-dimer, and a CT pulmonary angiogram. The tropi was negative. NT-proBNP was also within normal ranges. However, D-dimer we detected to be 1,200 nanograms per milliliter, which was well above the normal range of less than 500 nanograms per milliliter. This was the course of the patient in the ED. Once we had a significantly raised D-dimer value, we assessed the Wells score for pulmonary embolism, which came up to be 4.5, giving a moderate risk of pulmonary thromboembolism. We also ascertained a Wells score for DVT, which was 4, again, giving a high likelihood of the patient having DVT. PERC score, or the pulmonary embolism rule-out criteria, was again positive. 3 findings, which were limb swelling, tachycardia, and hypoxia. And following all of this, we had a suspicious gestalt of pulmonary embolism, approximately more than 15%. Following which, we took a CT pulmonary angiogram after ascertaining that the serum creatinine levels were normal as per the EEG. We found that the right pulmonary artery showed a thrombus, which was shown by a hyperdense filling defect as seen in the diagram below. We also did a venous Doppler of the left lower limb, which as you can see from the figure in front of you, on the left side you have the pre-compression image, which showed a thrombus in the femoral vein. The asterisk is indicative of the femoral vein. You can see that the compression, before compressing the vein, this is how the lumen looked. And on your right, you have the same image after compressing the femoral vein. We can see here that the diameter is unchanged, hence indicating the presence of a thrombus. Course in the ED, as I said, the CTPA showed a hyperdense filling defect in the right main pulmonary trunk. The venous Doppler of the left lower limb was suggestive of a deep vein thrombosis in the left femoral vein extending into the left popliteal vein. The patient was then initiated on unfractionated heparin at the following dose. And for the next couple of days, the course was continued. She was then later switched to parenteral LMWH for the remaining course of the stay at the hospital, which totaled to a total of 3 days, following which she was discharged with injectable or parenteral low molecular weight heparin, which was injection clexane. And she was sent home after a total period of 3 days. The entire duration of stay of the patient here was uneventful. This is the first presentation of a typical pulmonary thromboembolism. We will now go to an atypical presentation of the same. This was a 41-year-old diabetic male who presented to the ER in the early hours a couple of days ago with complaints of retrosternal chest pain radiating to the left upper back, which was of onset of 3 hours prior to the visit to the ED. He was also complaining of upper abdominal discomfort with no significant cardiovascular or pulmonary history. All the relevant questions had a negative answer. On primary survey, he was completely fine, except for the fact that he was tachypneic. Airway, circulation, disability, and exposure were all good. There were no critical adjuncts initiated after the primary survey. These following primary adjuncts were done. The ECG revealed sinus tachycardia with no axis deviation and no significant STT abnormalities. 2D echocardiogram on screening was found to be normal, and the ABG was also metabolically fine. The ample history, he had no known allergies, he is a known diabetic on OHAs, no significant past history, the significant events leading to the current illness was that of retrosternal chest pain associated with upper abdominal discomfort and sweating of duration of 3 hours. This was the primary survey, following which we went ahead towards the secondary survey, which was unremarkable. The systemic examination again was unremarkable. All of the systems, including the cardiovascular and the pulmonary system and the GIT, were normal. Because the patient had a very insignificant primary and secondary survey, but his pain was still persisting despite having been escalated on analgesics, we were under the doubt as to what the possible cause could be. The initial provisional diagnosis from his clinical history was acute gastritis, acute pancreatitis, or the possibility of unstable angina. And we sent the following investigations once the patient was given adequate analgesics. The troponinine, serum lipase, amylase, and ultrasound abdomen with pelvis were done. But to our surprise, all of the above parameters were normal, but the patient was still in pain with no symptomatic relief despite having escalated analgesia. Now we had to think about other rare causes of the same persisting pain. Our first provisional was acute venous thromboembolism, probably a submassive one or a low probability one. And we could also think of lung consolidation, a low respiratory tract infection. Since the clinical gestalt of the possibility of VTE was less than 15% and the Wells score was 1.5, again showing a very low likelihood of thromboembolism, and the PERC score positive only for tachycardia, which we advised a gem such as a quantitative D-dimer. The D-dimer, however, was extremely high for the patient's age and normal levels. It was found to be almost 1,200 nanograms per ml. After ascertaining that serum creatinine levels were normal, we advised a CT pulmonary angiogram, which was suggestive of an eccentric hypodense filling defect in the anterior subsegmental branch of the lower lobe, which was likely a venous pulmonary thromboembolus. The patient was then initiated on oral antithrombotics with low molecular weight heparin, and then observed for a total period of 48 hours at the hospital, during which the course of stay was uneventful. The patient was then discharged from the hospital on the following. He was discharged on low molecular weight heparin, which was then tapered throughout the next week along with other supportive medications. He is doing fine and healthy. He is continuing his low molecular weight heparin as we speak of. These were the two presentations that we had in the last couple of months, one typical and one atypical of venous thromboembolus. I would now like to hand over the dais to Dr. Fani for further explanation.
Yeah, that was a very good presentation, telling us about both the typical and atypical presentation, especially the atypical case where the patient didn't have any classic signs or symptoms. It was quite a diagnostic challenge. Now, let us see. Dr. Fani will present us, throw light on few things, how to overcome the difficulties in diagnosing this condition. Our emergency room, Dr. Fani will take over.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, sir. So I will be speaking about how to diagnose PTE or how to have a high level of suspicion when you are thinking of an atypical presentation in the ER. Okay. So, coming to the clinical features of PTE, what are the clinical features? Means it should be an unexplained dyspnea, where we do not find any other reason for the dyspnea, or we do not know why there is a breathlessness. It's like a sudden onset, or the patient says that we don't know, previous history was not there. So we have to see all that. So unexplained dyspnea is one of the clinical features. And EC changes without any alternative diagnosis on chest X-ray, as we have mentioned earlier. So if the chest X-ray is normal and the EC changes are there, then we should have a suspicion of PTE. And chest pain, which is pleuritic and it is not subsiding on any analgesics. We have seen in the atypical presentation where the patient was given a lot of analgesics and trying to reduce the pain, but the pain was not at all subsiding. So this should be one of the clinical features of PTE. So always have a high suspicion when the pain is not reducing on any analgesics with the other features. And pain radiating to the shoulder generally indicates an infarct in the basilar segments. And proximal PTE may not have a focal pain. So these are some of the clinical features. And additionally, we can have syncope or confusion and convulsions in some patients. 3-4% patients have a syncope and 1-2% have convulsions or confusion. Okay, there is something called as a paradoxical embolism syndrome, where patients may have symptoms of CVA, like he might have a contralateral hemiparesis or slurring of speech, drowsiness, unexplained, but why we don't know. So this is a paradoxical embolism syndrome, where the clot might get dislodged into the left atrium and then have the neurological symptoms presenting. So in that scenario also, we should have a high suspicion of PTE. And coming to the physical examination, so as earlier mentioned, it does not predictably alter any vital sign. So it is not predicted that this sign would be altered due to PTE. It can be anything, but it does not alter any vital sign. So one half of the patients have a heart rate less than 100 per minute at diagnosis. When we are diagnosing the patient at diagnosis, the heart rate is generally less than 100. And one third have an abnormal vital signs which normalize in the ED on presentation. So, and the size of the clot, there's no clear correlation between the size of the clot and the heart rate or the oximetry. The oximetry can be abnormal also because in other conditions or when the clot is of smaller size. So if the there is nothing saying that when the clot is big, when the size of the clot is big, the initial heart rate could be high or low, or oximetry could not be proper, or it might show low oximetry. No, there's no clear correlation between them. And the pulse oximetry reading is lower in patients with proven PV than those without PV. Yes, this is obvious because proven PV patients generally do have a pulse oximetry reading which shows a low reading. Yeah. And a unilateral limb swelling, presence of Vs. As earlier mentioned, the presence of Vs may means like probability of PE might be less, but still focal Vs or rails or anything like that can be presented in PT also. So always have a high suspicion when you are seeing all these signs. Yes. And the gestalt interpretation of sick or not sick appearance of ED patients with possible PE can be deceiving. Yes, that is there. And patients with PE also demonstrate a low end tidal ETCO2 compared to healthy individuals. Yes, that can be checked once when we have the access to the ETCO2. That is not done in ER generally, not frequently at least. So coming to the findings on the chest radiograph, they include cardiomegaly, basilar atelectasis, infiltrate or pleural effusion. Infiltrates or pleural effusion can be there. There is something called as a Westermark sign in 5% patients. I'll be discussing that. And Hamilton's hump also. And findings of acute pulmonary hypertension on ECG increase the probability of PE. So as I've told, this is a chest X-ray of a patient where means like all the signs of PT have been shown. The arrowheads, they present means like they give a Westermark sign where there is oligemy of the means like lung parenchyma, and also the Hampton's hump indicated with a white arrow mark there showing the infarction. And also there is something called as a Pala sign where there is a means like the pulmonary artery is very prominent. So that is indicated with a black arrow mark there. So these signs have to be seen on a chest radiograph when you are suspecting a PT. If not, also always have a high clinical suspicion of PT when you are it's like when the patient is the patient has presented atypically. Okay, so coming to the ECG changes, as I've discussed, see this ECG shows a sinus tachycardia, and also it shows S1 Q3 T3 pattern where S wave lead one has S waves, Q3 and T3 is also seen along with the signs of right ventricular strain pattern is there, and also T inversions in the anterior leads. So based on this, based on the ECG findings and presentation of the patient, see, we have a score on based on the ECG findings, which has certain parameters on that, and tachycardia more than 100, incomplete right bundle branch block, complete right bundle branch block. So the scores have been divided from the score of 1 to 4. So if you have any of these signs, we have to interpret that if the signs are there, and this increases the probability of PT. So the high suspicion makes us go through these scores, and also it gives us a high probability of suspicion of PT. So coming to the other scores, we have two scores where to rule in PT. Actually, these are the revised Geneva scores and also simplified revised Geneva scores. As you can see, the total probability from the scores is mentioned there. So what are the parameters which have to be considered in revised Geneva and simplified revised Geneva scores? Age more than 65, it carries 1 point in revised Geneva score, and also in simplified revised Geneva score, it carries a point of 1. So all these things, all the parameters have been given certain scores to interpret the scoring and to predict how much of the PT could be possible. So a total score of revised Geneva score of 0 to 3 indicates low probability, where a score of 4 to 10 indicates moderate, and a score of 10, more than 10 indicates high probability of PE. And coming to the simplified revised Geneva score, any score less than 4 or equal to 4, indicates that pulmonary embolism is unlikely. So anything on the simplified revised Geneva score more than 4, it indicates that pulmonary embolism is more likely, and all means like patient could have a PT. Coming to the Well score for PT, So what are the points to be considered here? What are the parameters? Suspected DVT, alternative diagnosis less likely than PE, heart rate more than 100, prior venous thromboembolism, surgery or immobilization prior 4 weeks prior to the presentation, active malignancy and hemoptysis. So these are the parameters which have to be considered in the well score for PT. So score has been given as 1 to 3 and depends upon the parameter and depends upon what symptoms the patient is having. So the probability of pulmonary embolism is more than 6 points, it's high risk, 2 to 6, it's moderate, and less than 2, it is low risk. So as you have seen in the atypical presentation also, the well score was around 1.5, which is very low risk. So this means like to rule in PE, we have to do the well score, which is very important and very useful in the emergency room while having a high suspicion of PT. So whenever there are two scores, we generally happen to compare the two scores, right? So just to know which score is more useful to the patients and also to suspect a certain condition in the emergency room. So on comparison of the Well score with the simplified revised Geneva score, there's a study made which shows that the Well score was more useful than simplified revised Geneva score. So again, it proves that the Well score is very important. And also when you are having a high suspicion of PT, it is better that you go with the Well score because the parameters are the parameters are easy to predict. And also the scoring is also easy. So while we have seen the ruling criteria and the scores for PE, there is something called as pulmonary embolism rule out criteria, right? So how can we rule out pulmonary embolism? So when you are trying to rule in pulmonary embolism, there should be some criteria to rule out it also. So what is that? So clinically low probability, that is less than 50% probability of PE based on the gestalt assessment. Age should be less than 50 years, heart rate less than 100, pulse oximetry more than 94 at room air, and there should be no hemoptysis, no prior VTEs, no surgery, no or trauma, or any epidural anesthesia for the last 4 weeks, no estrogen use, no unilateral leg swelling defined as asymmetrical calves on visual inspection with patient's heels raised off their bed. So all these signs should be there. And PERT score, the important thing is any one of the signs, if it is present, we cannot rule out PT. In order to rule out PT, all these 9 conditions have to be there. Then only we can rule out PT. Otherwise, if any one of the signs is there, the PT is not ruled out. As earlier in the case presentations, they have mentioned the PERT score has to be low. Yes, but still they had a tachycardia. The patient had a tachycardia. So always have the high suspicion of PT while dealing with the patients, because we just cannot let go of the diagnosis and we cannot avoid it, right? So basing on the clinical presentations and the scores, there is a nicely made flowchart for what to do when the patient is having signs and symptoms of pulmonary embolism. So as you can see that if the patient is having signs and symptoms of pulmonary embolism, if it is yes, and the clinical suspicion of PE is low, where the gestalt is less than 15%, that is comes under PERC score, or the well score is less than 2, what can we do? We have to go for, if the clinical suspicion is low, we have to go for the PERC rule. And if the PERC rule is positive, that is the criteria is satisfactory for PERC, then there is no, if not satisfactory for PERC, it is no PE. Okay, means like the signs of tachycardia, age less than 50, saturations are being maintained, there is no prior surgery, there was no history of previous thromboembolism. Then if all the 9 criteria have been satisfied, then there would be no PE. But if the PERC rule gives you any kind of suspicion of PT, then we have to have a high suspicion. And what can we do? I'll be discussing that again. So if the clinical suspicion is low and the gestalt is less than 15%, we'll go for PERT2. If the clinical suspicion is not low and the gestalt is not less than 15%, then what we have to do? So you can see if that is not there, then we have to go see that the PE is more unlikely, where the well score is 2 to 4 or the simplified revised Geneva score is 2 to 4. So again, coming to that, when the gestalt is more than 40% or well score is more than 4 and revised simplified revised Geneva score is more than 4, we have to consider low molecular weight heparin if no contraindications. So what are the means like contraindication should not be there. Yes, for any drug when there is when we are giving some kind of anticoagulation, we have to see that the contraindications are not there. So any previous antiplatelet use or anticoagulation has been on, we have to see that any bleeding manifestations are there or any previous history of CVA. We have to consider all those and then start low molecular weight heparin. So and if the patient is not having any signs and symptoms of pulmonary embolism, then there is no PE clearly. So what we have to do if PERT rule is being satisfied and also when we have a high suspicion of PE where the well score and the simplified revised Geneva score is there, so we will order a quantitative D-dimer. Yes, and the quantitative D-dimer should be less than 500 nanograms per ml or and it should be either it should be more than 500 nanograms per ml. Yes, so if it is more than 500, then we order imaging. Before going for the imaging, we have to see the serum creatinine of the patients, because as you all know, the imaging this thing is CT pulmonary angio, so it is a world standard for PE. So before that, if the serum creatinine is normal and the GFR is less than 60 ml per minute, then we have to go for a VQ perfusion scan or a VQ SPECT, where the VQ SPECT or the VQ perfusion shows a it has three things: homogeneous, diagnostic, and non-diagnostic. So if it is homogeneous perfusion, that means it's normal. Then there is no PE. We can clear-cutly rule out PE. But if it is diagnostic, yes, then we have to go for a CTPA. And it is non-diagnostic also, we have to go for a CTPA. And what the CTPA depicts is what we have to see. If the CTPA is positive for positive, then obviously it is PE. If the CTPA is negative, but still we have a high suspicion of PT, then we have to go for a bilateral lower extremity compression ultrasound, which helps us to have a suspicion on PT. Then if it is positive, where the vessels are not able to non-compressible, then it is likely to be PE. And if this thing is negative, when you do the ultrasound, if it is the veins are compressible and the flow is very good, when you do a Doppler also, we can do that. So the flow is good, then the most likely it won't be a PE. So this thing, these are the scores and also the clinical parameters where we have to have a high suspicion. And this flow chart is also very good, where it helps us to quantify every score and every clinical scenario and come to a perfect, ultimate diagnosis of a PT or not PT. So as we know, we know the inpatient treatment for PE, but there is something called as an outpatient treatment also, where the patient can be treated on an outpatient basis. So in order to discharge the patient on some medications, or when we are thinking of an outpatient treatment for PE, what are the parameters which we have to see? So it should be applied only to low risk patients. Yes, high risk patients, definitely they have to be admitted. We cannot discharge them from the emergency room. Patients who can adhere to the treatment, that means they have to be properly counseled that the treatment is important to them, and they have to be made understood that if they are not going to follow the treatment, there is a risk that it might increase and it could be a endangered to their life, and it could be a life-threatening event. So, and they should be able to get the medications also, and the proper medication, then the correct medications, and they should have the access to the medical facility whenever possible. So easy access should be there for the medical facility. Coming to the third point, incidence of mortality is low with outpatient treatment. Yes, when all these parameters are satisfied, the mortality will be low. Yeah. And absence of high risk features exist, then observation followed by discharge is an option. So this thing is, when high risk patients are there, but you think that they can adhere to the treatment, they can procure the medications, they can follow the proper guidance given by the doctor, and also they have a proper medical facility available, then you can think of discharging the patients. But before that, we have to observe the patients in the emergency room. Then only we can come to a conclusion whether to discharge or not to discharge. If you are going to discharge, then all the criteria should be satisfied. So what are the prognostic systems to look for low risk patients? So as I mentioned in the earlier slide, the patient should be under low risk, right? So what are the prognostic systems? See, there are two systems which can be used. One is a simplified PE severity index score, and one is modified HISTIA criteria. So based on these two criteria, we can decide whether the patient comes under low risk or not. So while coming to the simplified PE index score, zero is low risk and any one of the signs is high risk. So what are the parameters? Age should be more than 80 years, history of malignancy, history of heart failure, pulse more than 100 beats per minute, SBP more than less than 100, and oxygen saturation less than 90. So any of these parameters is not present. If the age is less than 80, there is no history of cancer, there is no history of heart failure previously or chronic lung disease, and there is no tachycardia, and there is no hypotension, and there is no hypoxia, then the score will be zero. Then we can say that yes, the patient come under low risk. And if the and if any one of the criteria is there, then they definitely come under high risk, where there is an option, as I've told, that we can observe the patient and then discharge, if at all it is possible. And coming to the modified HTI criteria, it has a lot of other parameters in it. That is, SBP should be more than 100. And it just identifies the low risk. It does not tell you whether the patient comes under high risk or not. It is used only to say whether the patient is of low risk or not. That's it. So the parameters are, SBP should be more than 100. There is no thrombolysis needed, no active bleeding. Oxygen saturation, again, more than 94 on room air, not already anticoagulated, no more than 2 doses of IV narcotics in the ED. That means the analgesics which we use to reduce the pain should not be more than 2 doses. That means if you are giving repeated analgesics, then it doesn't give you a chance of low risk. And absence of other medical or social reasons to admit. And creatinine clearance more than 30, and there should be no HIT, other HIT, it is heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. These things should not be there. Then only it comes under low risk. So all these criteria should be met before trying to say that the patient comes under the low risk category, so that we can discharge them. Okay. So coming to the gist, see, what we have seen is the scoring systems, the rule in and rule out criteria for pulmonary embolism, and also for low-risk criteria where the patients can be discharged. And we have seen that where the patient is of low-risk or high-risk patients. So these things keeping in mind, we have to always have a high suspicion in the emergency room of PTE. And also when the clinical parameters are not there, still we think that it could be PTE, then we have to rule out. Because it could be a catastrophic event if we miss the diagnosis. And it is generally missed diagnosis in the emergency room, where we have a low suspicion for PE and the patient might land up in PE. So always have a high suspicion, always go with the clinical presentation of the patient. We have many scoring systems. We have to use them so that we cannot miss the diagnosis. And also there is low risk and high risk patients where we can just decide whether to admit the patients or whether we can discharge the patients safely. And also rule in, rule out criteria that comes from the scoring systems itself, where you have two rule in criteria, like the Geneva score and the Wells criteria, and rule out criteria is the PERC score. So using all these things, I think we can make a better diagnosis of PTE, and in order to not miss it. That is it. Okay. I thank everyone for giving me this opportunity today. Over to Dr. Raghavendra, sir.
That was a very crisp way to discuss how to diagnose this condition, how to rule in, rule out this condition, and how to make use of various diagnostic adjuncts in order to go ahead in the diagnosis of this condition. And now let us proceed to the question and answer session and the chat box. There are quite interesting questions there asked by the participants. What are the reasons for mortality in pulmonary thromboembolism? I think Dr. Ria, can you tell about the what are the major reasons for mortality in this condition?
Sure, sir. One of the major causes of mortality would be a complete occlusion of the pulmonary artery, leading to a circulatory collapse. That could be the most common cause. Also, it could be due to a progressive heart failure, leading to, again, circulatory failure and collapse. These could be counted in as one of the most common causes of mortality due to PD.
Okay. So the next question, which bedside test is done to find out the cause of pulmonary thromboembolism? Dr. Fani, can you tell us about this thing?
Yes, sir. It's like a bedside test. Yes, we have other adjuncts also, but the most useful adjunct is the venous ultrasound, or the thing which we do is called as just a Doppler thing which we do in the emergency room. So by that, when we see that, as I've mentioned previously in the slides, if we see a non-compressibility of the vein, or if the when we do the Doppler, if there is no means like pickup of the flow, then we can suspect that it could be a PT, and it is very useful adjunct in the emergency room doing an ultrasound. Yes.
Okay. So the next question: what is the testing modality in conditions with contraindications to CTPA? So when CT pulmonary angiogram is contraindicated, what are the testing modalities? Okay, I would like to take this question. In this condition where CTPA is contraindicated, we have to go for a ventilation perfusion scan, especially the conditions when the patient is pregnant, in patients with the renal insufficiency, any allergies to the contrast agent. In these conditions, we can go for a ventilation perfusion scan. Basically, this is a scan where the patient is made to nebulize with aerosols containing the isotope. Then the scan is done. And there are two phases in this study, the ventilation phase and the perfusion phase. Any scan with homogeneous scintillation throughout the lung fields in the perfusion portion is nearly 100% sensitive in excluding the pulmonary embolism. Whereas in the perfusion phase, the presence of two or more central wedge-shaped defects, that indicates that there is a probability of pulmonary embolism by 80%. And then someone has asked regarding which bedside imaging is helpful in diagnosing pulmonary embolism. I think I can take this question. It's basically the lung ultrasound examination. All the emergency room physicians must make use of the lung ultrasound machine. We have to follow the blue protocol basically and rule out, exclude the alternate diagnosis like any consolidations, pulmonary edema, pleural effusion. All these things have to be ruled out. Exclude the other diagnosis and then look for pulmonary thromboembolism. The lung ultrasound examination coupled with the Wells score, it gives a fair good idea about this diagnosis. This is what the guidelines say. And then the next question, are there any factors which influence the change in D-dimer values other than pulmonary embolism? Dr. Ria, can you tell about this thing?
Yes, sir. D-dimer values may either be false positive or false negative to our dismay. So somebody who is not of a higher risk of suspected PT would have a probable false negative PT. These conditions would include a tiny, probably isolated calf vein thrombosis, DVT, which is of a single vein, which is isolated. Or if the patient has been having symptoms for more than 5 days, a long-lasting symptomatology could lead to a false negative D-dimer. Or it could also be that a tiny lung infarct or a very tiny lung subsegmental pulmonary thromboembolism could lead to a false negative D-dimer value. On the other hand, a high false positive or a positive value of the D-dimer could be seen in multiple conditions. A pregnant lady may have high D-dimer levels. Somebody who's got sepsis, underlying infections, somebody who's post-trauma, somebody who has a history of prior surgeries or active malignancies are all examples of conditions which could present with false positive PD, D-dimers.
Okay. Okay, let's go to the next question. Why is the revised Geneva score system modified into a simplified revised Geneva score system? Dr. Fani, can you take this question?
Yes, sir. Actually, revised Geneva score system has a parameters of 1 to 5, which least parameter scoring is 1 and the highest score given is 5. And basically, they have come up with a simplified revised Geneva score because they wanted to reduce the errors in revised Geneva score, where the calculations could be a bit hard and calculation might go wrong. So what they have done in the simplified revised Geneva system is scoring is they have given all the parameters a score of 1 so that we can just add it and it could be a faster calculation and the calculation might not go wrong. Whereas when compared to the revised Geneva system, the calculations might be wrong at some time. So this is why they have come up with a simplified revised Geneva scoring system.
The single point or score of 1 given for all the parameters in
yes.
simplified Geneva score.
Yes.
Avoids all the calculation errors or mistakes.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. That was a very good answer, Fani. I thank you, Dr. Fani. Thank you, Dr. Ria, for your very good presentations. I thank all the participants for your enthusiastic participation and time and enthusiasm in participation of the question and answer round. Thank you, everyone.